So I say to him, have you seen the chest hair on Matty the Avocado? He's got an infinite amount.
He's a very hairy guy, but mathematically speaking, I don't say it's infinite.
You think I'm a stenod? That I don't understand set theory? Okay, let's say that set A is all the hairs on the chest of that Faccia de Culo, Matty the Avocado. And set B is cardinal numbers.
What are you, a bacalon? You're setting up a correspondence between two sets, in which the first set is finite.
Who says it is? You keep counting and counting, you never run out of hair. So infinity is not a number, but a way of expressing a process that just never ends.
What, you think I'm a clown? You think you can sit there and mess with the work of the greatest mathematicians, and I'm gonna take it like a fanalon? Remember what happened to Jimmy the Trash Can when he claimed he proved uniform convergence?
Yeah, he got whacked by the math department at the University of Toronto.
So, let's just enjoy the veal and the wine and not get ubats.
My friend, I could do that forever.
Hey, what did I say?
Today on the show, infinity, cosmology, and black holes. And now he's got an infinite number of monkeys and an infinite number of typewriters. One monkey's got writer's block. What does he do? Forget about it. Colin McEnroe.
Well, it's an interesting question, actually. If you've got an infinite number of monkeys and an infinite number of typewriters and one typewriter, you take one typewriter away, do you have the same number of monkeys and typewriters? And that's the kind of thing we'll be asking about today. Actually, and believe it or not, the Jainist mathematicians, 4th to 3rd century BC, explored that very question about whether, in fact, infinities could be different sizes. It's the kind of thing we're going to talk about today. My competence will be exhausted within 15 minutes, if not sooner. And before I even introduce our guests, I just want to say, I want to recall, and I think Stephen Strogatz has heard this story from me before, that it's my fault that I won't understand things. That when I was a freshman at Yale, I was assigned to a faculty advisor, and he was this very gentle, soft-spoken Frenchman, and he wanted me to study math, and I did everything I possibly could to avoid it, and eventually to avoid him, so I wouldn't have to have conversations with him about why I was not studying math. His name was Abraham Robinson. He was, at that point, one of the living experts in the mathematical question of infinity, which I'm doing a show on today and which I don't understand, and it's my fault because I avoided Abraham Robinson. I had a chance to hang out with one of the great mathematicians of the 20th century, and I was too stupid to know that. All right, so I just had to make that little confession. Now, we are going to talk about infinity today. It is a term that people kind of sling around. We all do it, without maybe necessarily kind of putting it in our palm and examining it for what it is. So that's what we're going to try to do. A little later in the show, you're going to meet an old friend, Ronald Mallett. He's a research professor of physics at the University of Connecticut, one of the leading theoreticians about time travel in the world. We'll be next year doing a Discovery Channel program actually about that. But before we start with Ron, we're going to go to Stephen Strogatz, also a familiar voice on the show, professor of mathematics at Cornell. He's the author of The Joy of X, A Guided Tour of Math from 1 to Infinity. We sort of fell in love with his work when he was doing a much heralded series of columns on the website of the New York Times about math. So, Stephen Strogatz, let's just start with the whole notion of infinity. Is there a way even to define the term?
Well, you know, it's the sort of thing that kids love to play with. I think I might have first heard about it in elementary school, you know, on the playground, the kind of thing where some kid will say to another, "There's name any number. I could always tell a number bigger than your number, you know." And then someone will say, "Well, my number is infinity. Try to beat that."
Right.
So this immediately, you know, is a showstopper. Except, as you said, I think, during the introduction, it was mentioned that infinity probably really shouldn't be thought of as a number.
Mm-hmm.
It's something else. I mean, if it's a number, it's a very bizarre number because, like, if you add 1 to it, is it still infinity, but yet it got bigger? You know, how could that be? It doesn't behave like any number we're used to thinking about.
No, when we think about very large numbers, and let's take a very, very quick trip down a side trail. I mean, the numbers we also remember, if we heard about infinity on the playground when we were in fifth grade, then maybe hanging around, you know, the basketball hoops when we were in seventh grade, somebody might have mentioned Google and Googleplex, that those were really, really big numbers. Some really smart kid who knew about that. And those are often kind of thrown around. If infinity is not a number, but there have to be numbers representing really incredibly large numbers, those are the numbers we hear about. Can you just give us kind of a thumbnail on those?
Oof. I mean, those are tiny, even though we think of them as big numbers. You know, I think if I remember right, a Google might be a 1 followed by 100 zeros. Is that right?
Right. And then Google's like some version of Google. It's like.
Yeah, I think it's like maybe.
Google with 100 Googles after.
Yeah, something like that. So,
but those are
just that's,
sort of
course, why. Yeah. That's where Google got its name, the company. You know, it was supposed to convey how big the web is.
So just a way of thinking about really large numbers. So infinity is not a number. It's an expression of that notion that you just said, that any number that you could think of, there would be a number that came after it, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it was something, you know, that occurs to, like we say, every little kid thinks about this at some point. And historically, we know that the Greeks, 2,000 years ago, were worrying about it. There were paradoxes about infinity. Created by a man named Zeno, who was one of Socrates' teachers. And Zeno asks a question that occurs to a lot of people. You know, one version of it that your listeners may have heard about is, like, if I go halfway to the wall and then halfway from there to the wall and I keep going half the distance every time, will I ever get to the wall? This was something we used to worry about when we were, teenagers. Something about teenage angst probably there.
You know, when we add Ron to the conversation, we can talk about whether it's important to worry about that in terms of the universe. But is there, except in terms of the systems of mathematics themselves, is there a reason really to worry or think about infinity?
Oh, we have lots of reasons to think about it. Lots of calculations become much easier if you allow yourself to work with infinity. The whole power of calculus is based on taming infinity in a way that makes it into a productive concept rather than a paradoxical one.
But why would that be? I think Ron is going to talk to us about tensor calculus at some point. But why would calculus be a way of taming infinity?
Well, one of the early questions where the idea of infinity proved itself to be valuable was the question of figuring out the distance around a circle. You know, it's something that everybody learns in geometry class, this formula that the circumference of a circle is pi times the diameter. Mm-hmm. But what's this number pi? Which for a lot of people, pi is sort of the symbol of infinity. My kids think of it that way when they think of all those digits that just keep going and going and going. They even like to memorize a few of them, 3.1415. But so what does pi have to do with infinity and circles? If you're trying to figure out how far it is to go around a circle, that is what the circumference is, the way that Archimedes approached this problem more than 2,000 years ago was he said, well, I can figure out the perimeter of a square. Now, a square is not really a circle, it's not a circle. But if I keep adding more sides to the square, so I make it a hexagon, an octagon, and as you keep adding more and more sides, that shape starts to look more and more like a circle. So you could think of a circle as the limit of a polygon, a shape with many sides, as the number of those sides goes off to infinity. And it's only when you sort of allow yourself to take it to the limit all the way out to infinity that you get the correct number for pi.
Oh, we're talking about infinity. I should say that at a certain point in this show, we can all take bets on when it is. My brain is going to melt. And so it would be really, really helpful if people had their own questions, their own observations that they could call in with. 860-275-7266. If you're listening here on Thursday afternoon, we're live. You can call in. 860-275-7266. Please do call in about infinity. So the Jainists, Indian mathematicians working in the 4th to 3rd century BC, did say things like, if you remove a part from infinity or add a part to infinity, what remains is infinity. But Stephen Strogatz, at a certain point, mathematicians began exploring, and we should say, this question of infinity has intrigued, has brought to the table just, everybody, Plato, Aristotle, Aquinas, Bertrand Russell, Kurt Gödel, Galileo, you name it. At some point they'd have to sort of tackle Wittgenstein. At some point everybody would have to, Kant, you'd have to tackle infinity. So at one point, and this is kind of, we're about to enter brain-melting territory. At one point, a mathematician named Georg Cantor began exploring the question about whether all infinities were the same. or whether there could be different size infinities, which kind of doesn't make a whole lot of sense, at least intuitively. I'll hand the baton to you, though. I mean, the good news about this is that what we're about to talk about is something that any fourth grader can understand, the notion of set theory, the notion of grouping things in sets. But it does get a little complicated from there, right?
Well, it sure does. We have jumped over about 2,000 years of history
right.
to go to Cantor, and that's fine. We can go there. I mean, but I can't resist mentioning, though, that for in those 2,000 years between, say, Aristotle all the way up to Cantor, it was a big deal to worry about infinity. And people, you know, as you mentioned, Aquinas, there was theological significance to it because people were saying things like, well, only God could be infinite. And so when the monk Giordano Bruno in the 1500s entertained the idea that God in his infinite powers could have created infinitely many worlds like our world, you know, and so this raised the question of would there be infinitely many saviors? Well, anyway, he was considered a heretic and was burned alive for even daring to think about infinity. So it's a dangerous subject for all kinds of reasons. But jumping ahead then to Cantor now in the late 1800s, he said, look, let's think about infinity a little bit and ask ourselves this question that you just raised. Could there be some infinities that are bigger than others? Now, historically, people would have thought that question was nonsensical, that infinity is just the biggest conceivable thing. There can't be any infinity bigger than infinity. But Cantor approached it by thinking this way, that he said, if we want to talk about what the number he sort of went to basics. What does a number even mean? So like if I say the number 3, we know how we understand that. If you were teaching a little kid, you'd have them count on their fingers or make sounds, and they'd go 1, 2, 3. So there the 3 fingers correspond to the 3 sounds, 1, 2, 3. And that correspondence, that is those 3 sounds match up sort of like a buddy system. 1 corresponds to the first finger, 2 is the buddy of the second finger, 3 is the buddy of the third finger. That kind of buddy system is fundamental to the idea of what mathematicians call a one-to-one correspondence, which is how we define different kinds of infinity. So like if I want to say, I mean, here's the kind of wild thing that Cantor thought of. He asked, are there more numbers, you know, numbers like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or are there more even numbers, numbers like 2, 4, 6, 8, 10? And you would think at first, that's a crazy question. Of course, there's more numbers because it includes all the even numbers and all the odd numbers. It's sort of like there's twice as many numbers as even numbers. But Cantor said it's not right. You shouldn't think like that. You can make a buddy system where 1, the first number, corresponds to the first even number, 2. 2, the next number, corresponds to the second even number, 4. And in general, you could just pair up all the numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, with all the even numbers, 2, 4, 6, 8, all the way out to infinity. And he said, since there is this buddy system between even numbers and ordinary numbers, they have the same level of infinity.
So, but there are some things that wouldn't have the same level of infinity,
right? I mean, once he introduced that concept of this buddy system, or as I say, technically known as a one-to-one correspondence, he began hunting around. Are there any sets he could think of that would have such an enormous infinity that they couldn't be paired up with the ordinary counting numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. And, you know, first he tried thinking of all possible fractions. You know, there's lots of fractions. Well, he found a way to pair up all the fractions with the counting numbers, so that turned out not to be a bigger infinity. And eventually, though, he did come up with an example, which is all the points on a line. Or you could think of it, if you want to think of it as numbers, all the decimals.
Mm-hmm.
So including, you know, not just fractions, but even decimals that don't repeat, like pi. You know, so rational plus irrational numbers would be the official way to say it. If you think of all possible decimals, Cantor gave this fantastic argument that proved you could never pair them up with the counting numbers, that no matter how you tried, there would always be a decimal that wasn't paired up, someone that didn't have a buddy.
Okay, my brain's melting. Let me grab a couple of calls here. We're going to get to Ron in just a second here, but I want to grab a few calls here from the people. Here's Seth and Ledyard. Did we just cover your thing, Seth, or is it something else?
You just touched on my topic, actually. I was in high school calculus class, and my teacher put a proof on the board. It was an equation where she proved that 0.9 repeating was exactly equal to 1. I was just wondering if your guest could touch on the concept of infinity when relating to decimals.
That's such a Stephen Strogatz question.
Well, thanks, Colin. That question is everybody's favorite question about infinity, because I think just about every kid who's told by his or her teacher that 0.9 repeating equals 1 doesn't believe it and doesn't like it. I know I didn't like it. The first time I heard it, I thought, you know, teacher, you could say as many 9s as you want, and I can subtract your number from 1. I'll just have that many zeros and then a little 1 at the end. And so it just seemed wrong. But the teacher gave all kinds of proofs that, no, in fact, 0.9 repeating is equal to 1. And it is. I mean, the teacher was right. I was wrong. And we just have trouble understanding this. Now, one way you could think about it would be the number 1/3, all of us, I think, would believe is the decimal 0.33333 with the threes going on forever. And so if you take that thing and multiply it by 3, if you do it as 3 times a third, that's 1. Whereas if you do it as 3 times 0.333 repeating, that's 0.999 repeating. So they have to be equal. If you don't like that argument, you can use the one that my friend Todd gave to me when I was on the playground. This was one of the guys I used to argue with. He said, no, the teacher's right. 0.9 repeating is equal to 1 because there's no number in between them. Mm-hmm. Try to think of a decimal that could sandwich in between 0.9 repeating and 1. And obviously you can't. There's no conceivable decimal that could fit in there. And so that means they have to be the same number, because we know with any two different numbers, there's always a number between them, for instance, their average.
People talked about this in your playground? Where'd you go to school, the Sorbonne?
No, this is Torrington. This is in Torrington, Connecticut, and it was Vogel Junior High School. And I can tell you that Todd was a wise guy. He would have fit in perfectly at the opening of your show.
Yeah, no, I'm sure. All right, we've got a couple more calls here. I just want to say, you callers, and the number, by the way, 860-275-7266666666. 860-275-7266 repeating. And the minute you mention a dimension, as long as we stay in math, we've got Strogatz. The minute you mention a dimension, I'm bringing Mallet in from the bullpen. He's warming up out there right now. So just be aware. All right, here's Val from Hartford. Hi, Val.
Hey, good day. How are you?
Good.
For me, what I've always thought of infinity, when I think of a positive number and you add to it, you add, sooner or later you come to an end. But when you broach zero and go into the negative quadrant or anything, that seems to me like it's all correspondent. There is no...
Whoop, he got cut off. He got sucked into a black hole. We'll have to send Ronald Mallet in there to get him. But although he's talking about negative numbers, and my understanding of Georg Cantor's theories was that he didn't get into negative numbers at all, right? He talked about infinity exclusively in terms of positive numbers.
That's not right.
Based on my 5-minute attempt to understand this.
Yeah, no, he considered both positive and negative numbers, and they're really just mirror images of each other. The numbers go off to infinity in both the positive and the negative direction. Yeah, I don't know where you got that idea.
All right. So, let's take a little break here. We got David from Woodbury who's on the line, but I feel like he's going to head into Mallet territory. So why don't we just take a break? We'll combine Ronald Mallet and Stephen Strogatz. We'll get into physics. We'll get into the shape and size of the universe after this.
My maker. I am infinity. My art is forever ageless. I am infinity. We're beyond the reach of a lifespan. I am infinity. And live as long as this time can. I am infinity. Going to outlive my maker.
I would be in such better shape to do this show if I'd studied more math and science in college instead of having my own comedy troupe. But that's the way things are. We can't change those things. We are going to add to this conversation Ronald Mallet. He is a research professor of physics at UConn, one of the leading theorists about time travel, and obviously a pretty good guy to go to about infinity. So, Ronald Mallet, you've been listening to the mathematical side of this, and there's going to be a lot of places where the lines of physics and math cross, and so we'll have you and Stephen Strogatz kind of jam on those things. But we got to start out a little bit with physics. Before we get into infinity in space-time, I'm told by Patrick Scahill we need to start with the basics, and that would include a thumbnail sketch of how gravity works in Einstein's theory. So is that a good place for us to start here?
Yeah. I mean, as a matter of fact, it is. And I'm going to give you a crash course in Einstein's general theory of relativity, okay?
For free.
Right. The thing is that I should mention that Einstein's theory actually requires an understanding of what's known as a tensor calculus. So when a physicist says they have a theory, a model, that means that they actually have a mathematical model to describe the universe. And it took him 10 years to develop that. I'm going to explain it to you in far less than 10 minutes by doing an analogy. The thing is that what the way you can think of it is in Einstein's theory is imagine that space is like a rubber sheet, okay, like a trampoline, okay? And let's suppose that you take a bowling ball and put it on the rubber sheet. What's going to happen? The rubber sheet is going to curve. Now, suppose you put a marble on the rubber sheet. It's going to roll down until it hits the bowling ball. Now, imagine that the rubber sheet is there, but it's transparent, so that all you see is the bowling ball and the marble. So when I put the marble on, the marble rolls towards the bowling ball. Now, to you, since you can't see the rubber sheet, it'll appear to you, you'll say, ha-ha, some mysterious force that the bowling ball is exerting on the marble. But you know that what's really happening is that the bowling ball is curving the transparent rubber sheet. Well, what Einstein said is the force that we call gravity, that strange force, is really like that. In other words, the sun is bending the empty space around it, and we can't see that, just like the transparent rubber sheet. And so if you have the Earth sitting there, the Earth would actually, if it didn't have its little sideways motion, if you just set the Earth there, the Earth would actually roll down towards the sun, just in the way the marble did. Fortunately for us, when the solar system was formed, the Earth had a little bit of a sideways motion, and so it went around and around on that curved surface. This is something you could do with the marble, by the way. If you take the marble and just simply toss it a little bit on the side, it would actually orbit the bowling ball in the same way. So what Einstein said is what we call the force of gravity is not really a force at all. It's actually the curvature of empty space. And he gave experimental proof of that by the bending of light that goes by the sun due to the curvature of space. Now, the thing is that it turns out that in astrophysics, this concept of infinity occurs both on the level of the universe as a whole and also on the things that are happening in the universe. And it's related to this a concept that's called a singularity. Okay, and let me just mention that what a singularity is it just means something that you have when you divide anything by zero. So, I mean, any number that you divide by zero gives you infinity. Mm-hmm. And that is what a singularity is. Singularity is something that's been divided by zero. Now, how does that come up in cosmology? Well, number one, Einstein's theory is necessary to understand modern cosmology. Essentially, what we understand at the present time is that the universe started out with a Big Bang. Now, people sometimes think of the Big Bang as being an explosion into space, and that's not correct. What the Big Bang is the Big Bang is actually the creation of space and an expansion of space. And the way to think about that in terms of Einstein is imagine that space is like the surface of a balloon. And imagine you put little dots on the balloon. Those little dots would represent all the galaxies. And suppose you start blowing up the balloon. The balloon expands, and the little dots start moving away from each other. Okay, and that's actually what we see in the universe. We actually see the galaxies moving away from each other. And that was discovered back in 1929 by Hubble. The thing is that this expanding universe is the way in which we see the universe now. As a matter of fact, it's not only expanding, it's accelerating. But if you run time backwards, okay, if it was expanding, then that means if you run time backwards, the universe was smaller and smaller and smaller. And there comes a point in which the universe was essentially, you might say, zero in size. And so if you think of the density of the universe, and the density of the universe means the mass of the universe divided by the volume, as the volume is going to zero, that means that the matter in the universe is divided by zero. That gives you infinity. So that says that at some point at the Big Bang, we had an infinite density, and that's called the singularity, initial singularity at the beginning of the universe.
Actually, I'm going to pause you there just because we have a caller, Nick from Vermont, who actually has a question that's right on point, I think, right where you are right now. Nick from Vermont, you're on the air.
Oh, thank you very much. Well, actually, this is so interesting because I've always wondered about the idea of the Big Bang, of course. Everybody's heard about it. But I was wondering, from the standpoint of infinity, what was going on in that millisecond before the Big Bang?
That's an excellent question. There was no millisecond before the Big Bang because, see, this is the other misconception, is not only that the Big Bang was something that happened in space, but that it happened at a certain time. Before the Big Bang, there was no space. There was no time. At the Big Bang is when both space and time were created. So the question that you ask is literally not – there is no time. So there is nothing before the Big Bang. Now, I know that sounds, you know, a bit weird, but that's exactly the way in which the Big Bang occurred. It occurred from this initial singularity, and prior to that, there was no time and there was no space at all.
You know, before you go to the next place, I'm going to bring Stephen Strogatz in for just a second here, because as you're listening to all this, and this is, you know, Ronald Mallet is not your first date with a physicist, I'm sure. do math and physics, do they coincide here? I mean, math, to me, doesn't necessarily operate in space and time the way that he's talking about right now. I mean, to what degree are math and physics in a pretty even waltz with one another?
Well, I would say, in the personal case here of Ron and me, we're in very good harmony. I'm the kind of mathematician called an applied mathematician. So I love physics and all the rest of it, chemistry and biology. So, you know, and I think he gave a fantastic explanation of, in a very brief time, all these deep principles. But there are also other kinds of mathematicians who are more like poets, that is, pure mathematicians who can imagine anything they choose to imagine, whether it's physically real or not. And they might not necessarily be in so much harmony with either of us.
And we may swing back to that, too, because I think within the world of philosophy, not that we have a philosopher here, but within the philosophy world of philosophy, that's true, too, particularly in their approach to infinity. But Ronald Mallet, let's go back to you. So I just want to go back to one thing that you said, because I think it's one of the things that's really difficult for people like me. There's talk about the expanding universe. And, of course, for those of us who have a very primitive view of the universe, our questions are, expanding into what? How can it be any different from what it is?
Well, see, that's another point. In fact, it's not expanding into something, because the balloon analogy actually is a pretty close analogy. That is to say that the expansion of space is what's occurring, and that the galaxies are just going along for the ride as the space is expanding. But it's not expanding into anything. There's nothing outside of that. And that's hard for us to understand, because we want to think of it as expanding into something. If one wanted to, you could think of it as a hyperspace that it's going into, but it's not really a space outside of space. It's only space.
All right. I want to have Ron take us on a trip to a black hole in just a second. But before we do that, let's go to David in Woodbury. I'm not sure which one of our specialists he needs to talk to the most, but let's find out. Hi, David.
Oh, hi there. Hi. This has to do with the present, which now, how many times can you divide a second by two? You see, it can't stop. So that means the present is infinitely short.
Okay, you just blew my mind too. But this actually, maybe, Stephen Strogatz, I sort of threatened you with this before we went on the air. Maybe that's a way of just quickly touching on the notion of infinitesimals. He's talking about, because this is one of the ways in which math and physics really do try to look at questions about how much can something be divided down. I mean, the question of infinitesimals based, once again,
go ahead. David's question really gets to the heart of certain things. I mean, this is one of the questions that Zeno worried about. 2,500 years ago, what is the fundamental nature of time? Should we think of it as infinitely divisible, as David suggests, in which case you could just keep chopping things in half? Or is there a kind of atomic nature to time as well as to matter? You know, is there a smallest unit of time? I think that the jury is still out as far as physics goes, although we could see what Ron would say. But my understanding is that the best available information from quantum theories of gravity is that there should be a kind of smallest sensible unit of time. There's a smallest length that makes sense that we call the Planck length, and I think there's a corresponding Planck time. And to speak of any time shorter than that, I mean, it's unfathomably short time, but it's not zero. There wouldn't be any physics behind it. So I sort of think the current answer would be there is a smallest meaningful amount of time. What would you say to that, Ron?
Yeah, I mean, Stephen, you're exactly right. In fact, there's a precise number for the Planck time. It's 10 to the minus 43 seconds. So the thing is it's incredibly small, but it is finite, and it is a part of the concept of quantum mechanics. We still don't have a complete quantum theory of gravity to understand what that would mean in terms of how the universe would evolve at from those particular point in time. But from a theoretical standpoint, we do believe that it's likely that there is a smallest unit of time.
We're talking about infinity. We do welcome your conversations and your contributions. At a certain point, my voice is going to quiver. It will begin to quiver, and my hands will begin to shake, and that's when phone calls will be really important. 860-275-7266. Our guests are Stephen Strogatz. He's a professor of mathematics at Cornell University and the author of The Joy of X, A Guided Tour of Math from 1 to Infinity. Ronald Mallett is a research professor of physics at University of Connecticut, one of the leading experts on the notion of time travel. So Ron, take us on a trip to a black hole. What we know, even somebody like me knows that black holes have something to do with infinity. But that's about where I stop. I park my car right there.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, they very much do. And this notion of a singularity actually occurs in it. I mean, just to review briefly what a black hole is, all stars, including our sun, which is a sort of a middle-aged star that's been around for about 5 billion years, the way in which they operate is that they're hydrogen burners. That is to say that what happens is that hydrogen is crashed together due to gravity pushing it together to form helium. And as the hydrogen is forming helium from the this, let's say, fusion, in fact, it's called thermonuclear fusion, the energy that's given off is what gives us our light and life here on the Earth. Now, the thing is this isn't going to go on forever. And eventually, whenever the fuel begins to run out, the star will start to collapse. And as the star starts to collapse, the gravity around the star will start to escalate. And the gravity will get to such a point that the very light that tries to get away from the star gets pulled back to the star. So if you're standing outside and all the light is getting pulled back to the star, you see absolutely nothing. You see what's called a black hole. It's actually more like a black sphere than it is, a sort of way people have an image of a two-dimensional hole. But it's that means it's the region in which no light is able to reach outside of us. Now, that's probably a good thing that we can't see what's going on in there, because what a lot of physicists really feel is if you look at the equations carefully, inside the black hole, things are getting squished down to zero dimension. And that means that we're going to have a singularity. That is to say, we're going to have a number divided by zero, which we're going to have an infinity. And that's called a singularity. So we do think there's what's known as a central physical singularity inside the black hole. Now, what has sometimes been a problem for physicists is that, well, what happens if the black hole surface doesn't form? That is to say that it's called the event horizon, by the way, that area around the black hole. What happens if that isn't there? Then you would see what's called a naked singularity. That is to say, we could actually see the breakdown of the laws of physics occurring right before us, because it's no longer shielded from us by this event horizon, and it's called a naked singularity. Well, fortunately, at least from a theoretical standpoint, a physicist named Roger Penrose from England had postulated what's known as the cosmic censorship hypothesis. And as the name implies, what it says is that when there's no naked singularities, whenever you have this stellar collapse, they're always going to be surrounded by an event horizon. That is to say, we'll never see a naked singularity. We're protected by a cosmic censor. And this shows that within the notion of a black hole, we do have this notion of an infinity, which is at this singularity.
And Stephen Strogatz, and I hope I'm not throwing something at you that you can't react to, but I've never done it so far, so I mean, I've never stumped you so far. But I think it's important to – one thing that Ron said before that's worth emphasizing from your side of the aisle is that all of the things that he's seeing right now are not just things that physicists kind of spitball. Everything is underpinned by equations, right? Everything mm-hmm. that's in physics. I mean, if Ron or any other physicist says, well, infinity is occurring at the singularity, that has to be backed up with your end, right, with equations, with mathematics.
Yes, absolutely. And as far as we can tell, those equations are right, and they're being handled correctly by the physicists, so we're all on the same page here.
Yeah. I mean, Ron, do you want to say a little bit more about that? I mean, you can't just say stuff as a physicist.
No, as a matter of fact, that's why I said that whenever I'm giving lectures, I try to emphasize to people that even though I'm giving a picture of these things are backed up by a mathematical model. And as I emphasized, in this particular case, it was the tensor calculus. I think there's an interesting backstory by that. Incidentally, Einstein, when he was trying to develop the general theory of relativity, he felt he had to develop a new theory of gravity, because after he developed the special theory of relativity, which essentially says that the speed of light is the limit, the speed in the universe, it turned out that gravity could travel faster than that, according to Newton. So Einstein said, whoa, something's wrong here. So he had to develop a new theory of gravity, and that was his motivation for the general theory of relativity, was to do that. But he was kind of stumped as to where to go next with this. And it turned out that a friend of his, a college friend of his, who actually Einstein wasn't very good at taking classes, and he had a friend named Marcel Grossman who did take lecture notes.
I was afraid you were going to say it was Todd again.
No, it was Marcel Grossman. And Marcel Grossman's lecture notes essentially helped Einstein. Einstein studied his notes, and it helped him pass his courses. But in any case, Grossman eventually became a professional mathematician. And many years later, they stayed in contact, and Einstein told Grossman about his particular problem. And Grossman said, well, in fact, the mathematicians in the 19th century had been studying a whole new calculus called the absolute differential calculus, which is what we call now tensor calculus. And he said that he thought that this new calculus might help Einstein to develop his theory of gravity. And in fact, it did. But it took Einstein all of those years to completely understand it for himself, and then to develop his mathematical or develop his physical model that we understand about gravity.
All right, we've got some questions coming in here, and Carl, I think, has one for Stephen Strogatz about numbers. Josh from Hartford and David from Wallingford, we'll be happy to take your questions, too, 860-275-7266. We've got one more segment here to go. We should talk a little bit about philosophy and how it reacts to all this. 860-275-7266 is a number for you to call. You may tweet us at WNPRColin. We'll be back after this.
All right. Count it again, but you better get hit, kid. Here we go. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50, 55, 60, 65, 70, 75, 80, 85, 90, 95, 100.
So if orange is the new black, then what happens to black holes? And if they're so important, why do they only come in one color? Today's show was produced by Patrick Scahill, Betsy Kaplan, and me, with help from our interns, Garrett Connolly and Jonathan Scranton. The part of Bill Curry was played by Euclid. On tomorrow's show, new developments in the world of sports mascots. And now, back to Colin.
Yeah, very quickly, we are going to talk about this. We're going to rerun part of an older show we did about sports mascots, but also talk to Kelly Frank, who actually for a number of years was inside Raymond, the Tampa Bay Rays mascot. And one of the problems for the Tampa Bay Rays is that some nights there, if they're playing the Red Sox, there are more Red Sox fans in the Tampa Bay Stadium than there are Tampa Bay fans, at which point they start abusing the mascot. So anyway, horror stories, a little curlier here. 860-275-7266, the number to call in. Also, really quickly, want to remind you, October 2nd, we have an amazing panel we're doing at Watkinson School. It's all about the notion of ethical consumerism, making your purchases and your dinner choices and things like that accord with your beliefs about labor, workers' rights, animal rights, the environment, climate change, things like that. And we have a pretty sophisticated panel for you that will kind of tell you a little bit more about the continuum of all that, how it really works upstream and downstream from the actual point at which you spend your money. You'll learn a lot about it. We will not only philosophize about it, but we will teach you stuff about it, or they will anyway. I won't teach you anything. Anyway, you can just go on Watkinson.org, the Watkinson School website, find out a little bit more how to get tickets. We'd love to see you there. We'll tell you more about it in the days ahead. We're talking about infinity right now. With us, Ronald Mallett. He's a research professor of physics at the University of Connecticut, a leading authority on time travel. Stephen Strogatz is a professor of math at Cornell University, author of The Joy of X, a guided tour of math from one to infinity. We're going to take some calls here. If we have time, I'd love to get back to the black hole with Carl, but we actually have a full board of phone calls here. People have their own questions. We're going to start out with one. This is Carl from West Hartford with a question. I think it's more of a Stephen Strogatz question. Hi, Carl.
Hi. Yeah, I do have a question for your mathematician. You mentioned that there was more than one kind of infinity. There was infinity of all the numbers, the counting numbers, and then another infinity of all the points on a line, and that one infinity is bigger than the other. So my question is there an infinity between the two infinities that's bigger than all the points, all the counting numbers, and less than all the points on a line?
Uh-huh. Yes. Next question. No, go ahead.
This is an amazing question, and I have to wonder if Carl is a ringer, because this is one of the most famous unsolved problems in math. It's something that Cantor himself worried about very much when he was developing this notion of the different kinds of infinity. And so the kind of infinity that corresponds to the continuous set of points on a line he called the continuum. And his question was the one that Carl just asked and is now known as the continuum hypothesis, which says that there is no infinity sandwiched between the infinity of counting numbers and the infinity of points on a line, that those two are, so to speak, adjacent infinities and there's no room for any infinity in between them. But that was a hypothesis of Cantor's, and he tried very hard to prove it and never succeeded. Some people think that may have had something to do with why he spent so much time in a mental institution, although nowadays we don't really accept that. We think the poor guy just suffered from chronic depression, and he didn't really make himself crazy. He just had a disease. But be that as it may, in the years since Cantor's work, two of the great mathematicians of the 20th century settled the question of the continuum hypothesis in a very confusing way. One mathematician who Colin mentioned earlier, Kurt Gödel, proved that in a certain view of what set theory would be, that the continuum hypothesis could be false. But another mathematician, Paul Cohen, gave an argument that it also could be true. That is, set theory could be consistent with either answer to this question. And so we don't really know what the story is about the continuum hypothesis. Even to this day, we don't really know whether we should think of it as true or false.
So, Carl, if you thought of that question all by yourself, you might be a math genius. You might be like Matt Damon in Good Will Hunting or something. You might be like somebody that sneaks into math classrooms after hours and writes things on the wall that people can't figure out. So, however, you could also be a ringer. 860-275-7266. We're visiting with Ronald Mallett and with Stephen Strogatz. We're talking about infinity. Ooh, I was going to go to David there, but he's not on the board right now. 860-275-7266. Let me go instead to Dylan in Waterbury. Hi, Dylan. You're on the air.
Hi, yes. I've heard that infinity and the universe, that if you're trying to illustrate it, you would be doing something called a torus pattern. And I was wondering what your opinion of how the torus pattern relates to infinity, the universe, and zero-point energy.
All right. I've never heard of the torus pattern.
I hadn't heard of the torus pattern, but zero-point energy is another. That's a different concept. That has to do with the fact that at the smallest level, there's an uncertainty principle that has to do with energy and time. And what it says is that if you look at time on a small enough scale, you can have enough energy that you can create particles that can be created, virtual particles that can be created and then annihilated again, and that this fluctuation is what's going on in the universe, and that, in fact, could add energy to the universe. And, in fact, that's one of the problems that we're looking at in cosmology, is just how much energy could that actually be introducing into the universe.
I just want to go back to the black hole for a second, because, first of all, I think they're really interesting. But if we could go back to the black hole, Ronald Mallett, and also go back to your plastic sheet at the beginning. So the plastic sheet is this sheet that is deformed by the weight of a bowling ball, by the size of a bowling ball, and differently deformed by a pebble that's maybe rolled down towards the bowling ball. Is there a way to talk about the black hole in terms of that plastic sheet?
Well, as a matter of fact, that's a more correct way of talking about it, because what happens is that as the star is actually collapsing, space is becoming more and more warped. And so there's actually a point in which space is becoming so warped that you might say light has to climb up a hill that it can't climb up, okay? Becomes steep. the gradient steep, so that that's another way of looking at how light is getting trapped. And the singularity that's inside would be a region in which you had infinite curvature occurring in that. So that's actually the more correct picture of looking at a black hole.
So the plastic sheet at that point is, there's almost, is there literally a hole in the plastic sheet that just goes down to infinity?
In fact, the way you could think of it is if you took your finger and pushed on the sheet, and the sheet becomes more and more and more and more and more and more deformed, okay, to a point in which it actually begins to, at the singularity, rips. So you might say it would be a ripping of the fabric of space-time at that particular point.
All right. Let's grab a call from Liz. Liz in Glastonbury. Hi, Liz.
Hi. I have a question about imaginary numbers and the physical universe, and that if in the concept of a continuum or a linear aspect to infinity, doesn't it have to account for, like, the fluidity that is often explained formulaically with imaginary numbers? If that makes sense, it just seems to me that, you know, imaginary numbers is such a expanding way to think of kind of the finite way we go about discussing anything mathematically. So how does imaginary numbers fit into the concept of physical world and the science of affinity? That's my question.
I have no idea what that question was, but I love that you asked it. I know they don't get it on WFAN. It's only on public radio that anyone would ask
and
that question.
And I love Ron Mallett. He's great. I can't wait for the movie. Please, 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 Spike Lee, get on with the movie.
Yeah, Spike Lee is
thank you.
Making a movie. We should
can
have
I
said
hang
that.
Up for my answer?
You can hang up for your answer. I'll actually put you on hold for your answer. But before I let Ronald Mallett answer that question, you did say numbers. See, I didn't understand anything about the question, but she just said numbers a couple of times. So I'm going to start with Strogatz and see if Mallon has anything to say about
good.
It.
Good. I admire Ron for having a fan, a groupie out there.
Yeah. I'm sure you have your own.
but okay, yeah, let me take a stab at that. So, yeah, Liz's question is interesting. So imaginary numbers, just to remind people, were things that you heard about in algebra class, where if you tried to take a square root of a negative number, you know, that is, try to find a number which, when you multiply it by itself, equals something negative. There are no real numbers that can do that, but we invented in math this concept of imaginary numbers, which can be multiplied together to get negatives. And many people, when they learn about this, feel like, well, this is ridiculous. I mean, these numbers don't exist. Why are you making me learn about this? And it's a kind of another remarkable case where, just as in that tensor calculus example that Ron mentioned, where mathematicians think of something that then later corresponds to what's out there in the universe— the same was true with imaginary numbers, that they can be visualized as numbers that aren't one-dimensional like on a number line, but are two-dimensional. That is, I really mean the complex numbers, real plus imaginary numbers, together make a whole two-dimensional plane. And what's more, they really do exist in the universe. For instance, in the most basic equation of quantum mechanics, which is the deepest, you know, theory we have of the universe, along with relativity, that equation, the Schrodinger equation, has an imaginary number right in it. And so, you know, without imaginary numbers, we don't have atoms, we don't have reality. You need imaginary numbers to describe the workings of the real universe.
Ryan, you want to jump off from there?
I mean, I think Stephen said it, you know, as well as I would. In fact, the way I would have said it. But that's right. I mean, imaginary numbers play a real way. They actually are a part of the universe, and we couldn't understand how the universe functions without using them.
If I ask another question, I will rip a hole in space and time, and suddenly I will be appearing on Here and Now, which is the name of a show, but also probably a concept in physics. So I don't think I better do that. Instead, I'm going to thank both of our guests here. They're amazing guests, and I really this was a difficult topic, but I really do think that we laid out a lot of really fascinating stuff for people. So I hope you enjoyed it. If you have questions that you didn't get answered, you can email them to me at Colin, C-O-L-I-N, at WNPR.org, and I won't be able to answer them. I don't know what will happen when you email them to me, but I'll do something with them. Ronald Mallett is a research professor of physics at UConn. Wait for the Spike Lee movie about him. Stephen Strogatz is a professor of mathematics at Cornell University. He will appear in the sequel to The Avengers. He's the author of The Joy of X, a guided tour of math from one to infinity. We'll be back tomorrow with a mascot show.
I can't believe you guys.
The song that does it.
okay? Yes, I've had it. That's it. That's it. What are you doing?
Some people started singing it.
What is this? Hey!
No.
This is the last time, right? This is it. This is it.
I'm Kyone Wolf. Look at that. Your record stopped. I can't imagine how. Looks like some things ain't infinite, huh?